Now we were, shall we almost start now? Yes, we can start. I found the sutta that I was looking for. I think last, at the end of last time, we had just begun to look at the Satipatthana Sutta, I think, am I right? And we looked at the, about how contemplated our own bodies and the contents of our own bodies, just as if there were a bag, right? In this body, there are head hairs, body hairs, nails, teeth. We did that, right? That was the last thing we did? Am I right? Yes? Really dreary business. So that's what we're going to look at now. And I'm going to go further with that now. Because today, now we're going to do more meditating. Although I want to say something, and that is that for everyone, including people at home, which is that I looked at the schedule and it's possible next week I think I'm going to begin the Mahayana. Like, oh, where's, what happened to Rebecca? Oh, you're there, everything's happening? Oh, good, I just, there was one camera gone, I wonder what happened. You turned off that other camera? Oh, you put it back there. All right. Hello, camera. Hello, everybody. Sorry. Okay, good. We're all set. Just like I started, you know, I didn't, you know, I started the Theravada, the Pali sources, a little bit early. I didn't really do a whole lecture on the 7th on Buddhist science. And so then, now today is the, today's not the 19th, today's the 21st. No, that's in October. I'm sorry. Today's, yeah, not the 21st, right, September 21st. And it says the 28th, and then there's a gap of the October 5th, and then it starts again October 12th. So, but I'm sort of pushing things ahead. So on the 28th, I'm going to start with the Mahayana Sutra. And I will send out to everyone an electronic version. There's like three or four versions of my translation of the Vimalakirti. And also I'm going to send out the, I think people have from before, the page of the Heart Sutra, right? I think. So we're going to look at that next week. So this is the last day on the Pali Sutra. So that's what I'm trying to say. And there may be other changes forthcoming that may happen. Okay? So now we're looking here, and we're, this is where we were, where the monk reviews. Now, I want you to meditate reflectively. And there is a set of things called, there's three sets of things that are always referred to in both Pali, Mahayana and Sanskrit, Tibetan, everything. And they are called skanda dhatu ayatana, or kanda dhatu ayatana, that's same in Pali, which means something like aggregate, element, and medium. And these are things that one meditates on as a way of becoming more familiar with your own process. And you could think of yourself as made of a million atoms also, you know, or countless numbers of atoms. And there's different things, ways, your material body, that is, and your thoughts could be a cloud of, your mind could be a cloud of sensations and things. But, feelings in the fingertips and the bones, whatever. And then there's ideas and images and then sort of surging emotions and instincts, and then there's consciousness. And so there's many ways you could schematize your body-mind complex. But the Buddhists have developed three sets of things that they think are particularly useful, which when you do, you have a sense that you have kind of scanned your whole body-mind system. You follow me? Like if you're going to look for something in Tibet House, you have a blueprint of all the rooms of Tibet House, the walls, and you know where there's holes in the walls and windows or whatever, you know. And so then when you had such a blueprint and you looked everywhere within that blueprint, you would have a feeling that you'd fully searched the house. And so if you didn't find something that you were looking for in the house, you would then feel confident that it wasn't there. Do you follow? You're never going to find the absence of the thing, actually. Right? It's not like a thing that you find. It's like you just don't find it. But it only has meaning to you if you don't find it within a certain context. Do you follow me? A, you have to have a certain idea of what it is, and B, it has to be within a certain context. You follow? So the Buddhists over thousands of years have developed what they consider the most useful context. And what they're looking for, of course, maybe that's the first thing we should do. No, I don't want to maybe jump ahead to that. Maybe we should do that. That's the first thing we should do. Because, of course, you have to know what we're looking for. Okay? Now, in the context of Theravada, that means second noble truth. Second noble truth, when he gave the truth, I think we discussed that, when he gave the four noble truths, the first round, to his five former ascetical, self-mortifying disciples, he said craving was the root of the suffering, right? And he often says that when he's talking to people who are craving too much. And particularly that group, you have to realize Buddha is always talking to a specific group of people. He's not talking, he's not making dogmas. And if you remember, if you think back to, we read the Fruit of the Homeless Life Sutra, remember, Samanapala Sutra? And remember what the king complained about with the six previous teachers? He didn't really complain about their different philosophies particularly. He didn't take up them in detail. Actually, there are other Buddhist sutras where their different philosophies are critiqued. But he didn't do that. All he said was, I asked what is the fruit of the homeless life. And instead of answering my question, they told me their philosophy. Do you follow? And he rejected that. And the Buddha didn't tell him his philosophy. The Buddha started asking him questions, came up with something he couldn't reject as a fruit of the homeless life. Mainly his slave became his object of reverence. Was kind of social climbing, if you will, which the king had to admit, yeah, well, that's a fruit. He's no longer having to be my slave. And I wouldn't make him come back and be my slave. I wouldn't be able to do that. So that's a fruit. You know? And then he asked a few more questions, and then the Buddha started telling him about the experience of someone, not the theory, but the experience of someone who starts to be more ethical, who starts to be more controlled and calm in mind and more insightful, right? And goes right up to, but then he does throw in a little thing for the king. You know, I've been reading it again to my class at Columbia, so I'm very into that. So interesting, when he gets to the top of the form realm, and you all know these realms now, right? I've already told you about the form, formless, and the desire realm, form realm, formless realm, right? Well, when he gets to the top of the form realm in describing to the king, he doesn't go through the four formless states, or the four immaterial states, bodiless states. Your infinite space, consciousness, nothingness, and beyond consciousness, and unconsciousness. He doesn't do that. Instead, he talks at that point on top of the realm of pure matter, or pure form. He talks about pulling out a subtle body out of his coarse body, like a lucid dreaming body, or a bardo body, but done in the context of concentrated meditation, contemplation. So that one travels in a subtle body, like awakened dreaming or something like that. And then does all magical things, powerful magical things, because of course he's talking to this king who's obsessed with power. So he wants to have a fruit that the king will naturally think is something interesting. You know? And the poor king, remember at the end, the poor king can't quite really get the Dharma eye because he's too much still in denial of his guilt from having killed his parents. And tried to kill the Buddha, actually, and failed. Tried and failed to kill the Buddha. He drew blood from the body of the Buddha, though. Well, actually, no, Devadatta drew blood, I think, threw a boulder on him. The king only sent a wild elephant after the Buddha, a crazed elephant, that Ajatasattu king. But that elephant didn't fail to harm the Buddha because Buddha just petted it. It just kneeled down in front of Buddha. It saw Buddha, thought it was its mom, and then the Buddha petted it. You see, there are beautiful paintings of that in Thailand and all over the place about this mad elephant like this, Buddha's like that. So Buddha never, therefore, just gives a general theory. So therefore, to those guys who thought they were being really abstemious and avoiding all attachments and punishing themselves, actually, he said, it's craving that's your problem. You guys are actually craving for some sort of state of getting away from your body and some sort of state that you're having. There's plenty of chairs here. You can just find any chair. Don't worry. You don't have to even be quiet. You can just go find a chair. No problem. Step over anything, whatever. You're not in a church. You're in a weird Mongolian art show at Tibet House. because Mongolian culture has become mingled with Tibetan culture in a nice way. We're very fond of them. Okay, so, in a way, the Mongolian culture and the Mongolian people are kind of a proof of the pudding about Buddhism and about Tibetan Buddhism and the peaceful culture of Tibet. Because everyone knows they were the most ferocious conquerors on the planet, right? And then they became a bunch of old Manipemahum wimps themselves, Mongolians. Sort of. They still have a little Genghis Khan tinge to them. But they let themselves be crushed by the Russians and by everybody, you know, like the Tibetans did, you know. So they proved that that culture can make even a conquering nation, a very violent, difficult nation. It can become a peaceful nation, even at a sense of self, in the context of having to sacrifice its national boundary, its independent, like Tibet did also with invasion by the Chinese communists. So even America can do it. But luckily, we are at the end of things, so we won't be invaded by anybody else. We are in that situation where everybody has to simultaneously disarm in the planet today, or we're all doomed anyway. So I think we will, I'm pretty sure, as long as we get the right president. So back to this thing. So what are we looking for? Now meditate, I want you to meditate something. Okay, go in meditative mode, don't look at me. You know, half close your eyes, look at the tip of your nose, unless you have a teeny tiny one, and then you'll get cross-eyed, so in front of the tip of your nose, if you have a small nose, and meditate. Okay, and now in this meditation, try to remember a time when you were very, very upset, and maybe almost angry, maybe almost disappointed, deeply hurt feelings, really, really upset, depressed maybe. Try to remember such a time. And the point about that, remembering it, is to sort of, you have to do, it's a little tricky, and we won't be able to do the whole thing unless you're really unusual in a short minute. I'm just giving you a demonstration. We're rehearsing something together. And that is, when you feel that way, you want to really feel that way. In other words, really remember how you felt. So try to forget about the fact that you're remembering it and try to relive the feeling of like, I'm so hurt, oh, this is so terrible, I'm so upset, I'm going to be really angry about this. Whatever, you know, internal thoughts you had at that time, try to sort of relive them, which takes time. So I'm saying, I'm just introducing it, we're rehearsing it. So then when you do that, when you get a real strong feeling of how you felt when you were really feeling upset, perhaps just before you blew your top in anger, or you really felt awful in depression, just before you really went off the deep end, let's say, you felt truly, what we call in our expression, full of yourself. In other words, if someone had come up to you at that moment and said, you don't really exist, or something, you would have been really furious. You would have been completely rejecting any kind of weird Taoist, Buddhist idea, like you don't really exist. This is not happening. Go down the rabbit hole, take the red pill. You're not here, you know what I mean? You would just, what are you talking about? Of course I am, you know, and I'm real upset, you know, type of thing, right? You follow me? So that feeling of kind of absolute certainty that you're you is what you're looking for in this meditation. Which, when it's sort of just at the boundary of being connected to a strong emotion. So meditate on that. They say if you're really successful in this meditation, you will admit to yourself that all this talk about selflessness doesn't suit your gut feeling about yourself. You know, it sounds nice, and you know, the use of the word selfless about an altruistic or self-sacrificing person, you can understand. But when it refers to you, sorry, Buddha, I don't agree. I'm really me here. And you sort of realize, therefore, that Buddha's deeper statement, not just craving is the source of your suffering, but his statement that your misknowledge and misperception of yourself as a fixed, absolutely certain, definite, independent, real entity is mistaken. It's not something you agree with in a visceral way. So like when you're upset, if someone comes to you and say, well, I don't care if you're upset because you don't exist, or you're not real, you're going to be very more upset. You follow me? Another way perhaps to do it, keep meditating. Another way perhaps to do it that I find nowadays, I think very helpful, just myself, is you sort of think about your visual field, because you know when you're awake, you're very much involved in having visual impressions, visual stimuli. You know, you walk around looking around, see buildings, the street, the sky, the clouds, the people, the cars, the red lights, the green lights, the signposts. You know, we're really very much involved in our visual consciousness. So kind of go backwards in your visual consciousness. Sort of try to be conscious about process of your visual consciousness. And when you do, sort of go back and realize that you kind of feel that there's a register of something that you see. And that's registering in some sort of a continuous, unchanging, fixed point of subjectivity. It's like, you know, the negative plate of the camera, or the digital image screen in the back of the digital camera, or whatever, the sort of point that's a blank that takes the image. But that sort of blank feels like it's you. And it's because it can get all kinds of images because it's blank itself. But it's always there. And it's kind of unchanged. It's the same blank that gets the next image. And therefore you can have a continuity between the images, which are completely different, because there's this unchanging thing that's registering them in the back of your visual field, at your point of subjectivity. I find that kind of, it's a little lighter than the thing about remembering your strong emotion, although that's more important, that's the most important one, and we'll come back to that when we get to Mahayana too. But I find that visual point discovery useful. Now, okay, ding, that's enough of that meditating. So now let's take the five aggregates, and we'll go back to meditating in a minute. We're going to do a lot of meditating today. What we're really getting at now, you know, I never call Theravada the Hinayana, although they do in the Mahayana, they call it the Hinayana. And Hinayana is supposed to be opposite of Mahayana. Maha means great, but that really means kind of universal. And Hina means less than great, but actually it has even a stronger meaning. It means, Hina means lacking. Lacking, so not just, doesn't just mean lesser. The Tibetan translate Hinayana as teg men, and men means lower, but Hina doesn't mean lower. Hina means, Hina can be used as a particle after a word to mean such and such a thing, Hina, which means therefore like the English suffix less, you know, faultless, you know, substanceless. You know, in Sanskrit it would be the dravyahina, lacking dravya, you know, substance. So it means lack. So it's the lacking vehicle, literally. And what is it lacking? It's not lacking renunciation. It's not lacking realistic worldview of causation. It's not lacking, which are all common to Hinayana and Mahayana. It's not lacking realistic life purpose or motivation. It's not lacking realistic speech, evolutionary action, livelihood, realistic effort, realistic mindfulness, realistic wisdom. So it has all of the Eightfold Path. And when you're an arhat, you really do get free from the world. You attain a kind of nirvana, but you will attain Buddhahood also, according to the highest version of Mahayana. There's different versions. But the best version of Mahayana, what most scholars think, the arhat attains nirvana and becomes a Buddha. But what's inefficient about that becoming a Buddha is that once they become an arhat through the individual vehicle, through the lacking vehicle, they are never reborn on planet Earth as a human, but in certain heavenly planes, in the form realm, they are reborn by spontaneous apparition, because you don't have a womb birth there. They just appear there, kind of poof, like that. And when they do that, they progress into being bodhisattva and the bodhisattva stages and a Buddha in that heavenly plane, as almost like gods. I mean, they are gods, actually, a type of form realm god. And that seems groovy, but what's inefficient about it is it takes a really long time. Because their wisdom is deep, deeper than a bodhisattva's, on a human bodhisattva, often. Wisdom is deeper, but there's not much presence of suffering to them. They have a kind of clairvoyance. They can see people down below in earth and hell and all kind of horrible places, but it seems very far away to them. So they take their time. And time there, like a few minutes in some one of those heavenly planes, even in the desire realm, could be years in the earthly realm. So in the human realm, we are in the middle of the kind of universe of the different life forms, the evolutionary universe of different life forms. And we're therefore in a place where we're free of suffering enough to be able to think, to have leisure, to be able to examine and reflect about our things with almost divine-like, almost a divine type of intelligence. But we're also we're fragile, we're near vulnerability, we see suffering around us, we're close to the animals. We may or may not be aware of lower states than even the ordinary animal state, preta and hell being. But we therefore have a much better opportunity to develop more powerfully our compassion. And by developing compassion, the evolutionary development of our embodiment, going along with our wisdom mind, is much quicker in an evolutionary sense. So they have amazing and wonderful expression. When you meditate, don't achieve the cessation of ideation and sensation prematurely. Took me years to sort of remember that, to figure out what that really meant. Because it would seem like to go into like trance and become a great meditator or something, a master meditator, would be great at any time. But they say, don't do it prematurely. In other words, that would be going on the lacking path, on the individual path, because you would not have the vast motivation of the bodhisattva. The special virtue of the human embodiment is that we're more naturally aware of our mutual interentanglement. So the vision in the bodhisattva practice, which I don't want to go into more today because we're really on renunciation today, but the vision of all beings as one's mother, kind of the root of compassion, the diffusion of the human sense of dependency on the mother, that we all have somewhere in our unconscious, because we have in our memory, because we were all helpless infants for many years. So that feeling of affectionate and trusting and open, being embraced by a loving presence, diffuses onto all beings. Whereas in the God realm, it's more difficult. They're more remote, they're all floating around in their old energy field. They're all kind of, they don't even have a toothache. They don't have teeth. They don't need teeth. They're like big whales or something, big energy whales, feeling quite blissful. And therefore, okay, I got to get myself together to figure out the nature of the universe and attain nirvana, not just heaven, because I'm going to fall from this heaven if I lounge around the whole time. It's a little more indirect. And so the arhat, who becomes the, what you know, there's four states. You become what's called a stream enterer. When you conceive of the possibility of a being who is higher than the ordinary human being, who can teach you reality in such a way that you can come to understand it, and then a community of people who are trying to learn that reality and who have had various stages of understanding it that you can associate with, and then therefore you take refuge in the three jewels, and you become, in other words, you make your life purpose connect to this quest of reality, the teacher who points to the quest, points to the reality, and gives you methods of trying to understand it, and the companions who try to travel toward the understanding of it with you. That makes you a stream enterer, what they call srotapana. Then you become, you have a kind of experience of nobility, in other words, an equality of self, another level, where you become what's called a once returner, meaning you've gone up into the meditative planes, and even if you die, you will come back one more time as a human being, and then you will attain the individual vehicle style of nirvana, which is for yourself. But you would not obtain it in the bodhisattva way, where you embrace all beings simultaneously, like a Buddha does. And then you go a little further, though, in that direction, and you become a non-returner, where, as I say, you were reborn only in the form realm heaven, and where you don't have the ordinary craving or desire at all, but you still have the ignorance of thinking you're something different from everything else, and that your nirvana will be for you alone. And then to get from there to Buddhahood, where you have a nirvana that everyone is in, that embraces everything, you're very slow to get there, but you definitely will. That's how they understand it. You get this? Those are called the four higher states: stream runner, once returner, non-returner, and arhat. Okay? So in a way, therefore, that's why even in ancient India, from probably earlier than the first century before the Common Era, but at least from the textual record and from the tradition's own self-witnessing, from that 400 years after Buddha's time period, when the universal vehicle literature began to emerge, when Nagarjuna discovered the universal vehicle texts and so on, most of the mendicants, male and female mendicants, or the bhikshus and bhikshunis, were Mahayanists in theory and in motivation and bodhisattva vow orientation, this kind of thing. Most of them were. Very few persisted in being just individual vehicle people and said, I can't aspire to that bodhisattva thing. So that's why it's incorrect to call the whole Theravada the Hinayana. If you call the Theravada person, there is no Mahayana mendicant vow. Do you follow me? There's no Bodhisattva. The Bodhisattva vow is a different vow. It's not the vow to renounce the world, the ordinary home life, and put your whole, become professional seeker of freedom and Buddhahood and Nirvana and so on. That's why the Mahayana universal vehicle completely needs the individual vehicle and uses it and is based on it. And also the Mahayana people like Nagarjuna and then Asanga and Vasubandhu, etc., they founded many more monasteries. So the Western way, the modern historian way of thinking that somehow the Mahayana and the Theravada were always having a fight is completely wrong. The Mahayana spread the Theravada and the Mahasanghika. There was other branches of the I'm a menace. The Mahayana spread the monastic thing much more than the monastics by themselves had done. And most of the great Mahayana teachers were monastics. Even most of the Vajrayana teachers were monastics. We have these spectacular stories. Later we'll study them in the third set of things, like the Mahasiddhas, the great adepts, who were often, running around, like wearing a dhoti or stark naked or doing all kind of outrageous things in India. But most of the Vajrayana people were actually monastics. And it's considered easier to practice the Vajrayana as a monastic, which is another proof that the Vajrayana is not just some sort of big sex thing. It's dealing with the unconscious erotic energies, but it's not a big sex thing. Basically, I'll just give you a preview. That's ahead of time, okay? It's a yogic thing, okay? So what we're concentrated on with the Theravada, and that's why I love. I think my thing is very good. I think probably other translators will adopt it after I die. The individual vehicle, call this instead of saying Hinayana or Theravada, and because Theravada is not complete. I think there were 18 different groups, orders, or sects of the monastic Buddhists. So it's better to call them monastic Buddhists, and the Theravada were like 8 of them were fit into the Theravada. But another 10 were what's called the Mahasanghika, which only existed in China after a while, when it was all lost in India. And in Sri Lanka itself, which nowadays is the bastion of Orthodox, we're only the Theravada, that's the only Buddha's real teaching. There's a few people like that there who are deprived of that vaster view, the Mahayana view. But until the 10th century, Sri Lanka had Mahayana monastery and they had Vajrayana practitioners based in their monastic places. And actually their greatest architectural, great cave temple of Dambulla, and the great Polonnaruwa, lying down Buddha, they have the idea of multiple Buddhas, and they have very much a Mahayana-tinged, universal vehicle-tinged. Their most special art, actually, of the Theravada is connected to the Mahayana, even though they are saying, that's not the real thing. Okay, so that's really important to know. Okay, let's do the five aggregates. Let's meditate again now. Okay, I think we already did that, but you really have to learn the five aggregates. Your material body, which they have you scanning here in the mindfulness thing, right? The blood, the flesh, the fibers, the muscles, the bones, the ligaments, the nerves, the phlegm, the bile, the blood, the content of the stomach, of the upper and lower intestine, colon, the kidneys, the liver, the spleen, the lungs, the heart pumping, the brain, and the nerves down up and down the spinal ganglia. Just meditate on it all. In all of that, that feeling that you had, in which we briefly rehearsed, of the unchanging point behind your visual consciousness, or the real you that you felt was upset, that had to do whatever, react to this upset in such and such a way, and you weren't taking no for an answer, you're not really there. You're the real you that feels that it's really, really you there. You're looking for that in this extremely complex phenomena, set of things called your body and its processes. When you do that in a clearly introspective manner, scan your body down to minute detail, you probably will feel after some time that you can't find that solid, real you there physically, as a physical thing. You will reject. Although, you know, in ancient time you can see in ancient religious paintings, East and West, people have sometimes like a little homunculus, some place which is the soul. You know, there's a Krishna, a little Krishna in there, a little Jesus in there, a little something. You know, people, there's like in religious art, you can find that worldwide, pretty much. The Muslims don't bother with it because they don't have any human form. But most cultures have little images like that. And the Persians do have. Do you follow me? You know what I'm talking about? But there's no little homunculus. There's no little mini Bob somewhere in my chest or in my brain. Can't find it. That's pretty easy, don't you think? But of course, you can make it deeper and deeper. So then the next thing is, when I was feeling like I was really me, it was like a feeling, you know, like when I'm upset, I feel like choked up, we call it. You have a tight feeling in your solar plexus. Your breathing gets feeling constricted. Often when somebody has accused you of something or, you know, and insulted you in some way, when you try to speak, your throat feels kind of constricted and you stammer. You know, in the movies, the guy who's framed and falsely accused for the murder or for the theft or whatever it was, kind of, you get the drama of the movie about trying to clear his name because he stammers. You know, he doesn't really give his alibi very properly. Do you know what I mean? When the people come to get him, you know, it's common in the drama. So when you were feeling really you, when someone was provoking you, it was like a feeling, like a tension, tightness in the chest or in the throat, or maybe in the back of the neck. Surgeon psychologist here at NYU Hospital, Dr. Sarno, claims that the Americans' vast epidemic of lower back pain comes from feeling oppressed and you know, harmed and injured and aggressed upon. And sort of the back registers that feeling of resisting it, you know. The real you is like there in your lower back, in other words. He has a thing like that. Cured a lot of people by having them remember sense of injury registering by tension, what he calls myopathy, something. Myo means muscle in Greek. Okay. Anyway, muscle tension in the back, cutting off circulation and creating spinal stenosis and inflammation. So sensation, but then if you really scan all of your sensations, your feelings of pleasure, your feelings of tension and pain, your sort of feelings of no feeling, your numbness, neutral, feelingless feelings, or sensations is better than feelings, I think. If you do that, you don't find an absolute feeling, really, pretty easily, right? So you don't find that fixed self in a feeling. So then you go another level of subtlety to your ideas and images. And of course, when you inventory your body, that when you were meditating this minute, a second ago, or even the sensation, the sensations you physical, you know, your mental sensations of your physical body, you have an image of your body in your mind, like an anatomical image, you know, like as if you, whatever you learn, if you went to medical school or something, you have a very, very complex anatomical self-image. In general, you have a kind of feeling about what your, you know, the perimeter of your body, its shape and form, skin over muscle and bone, etc., fingers, some aching pain when you get older in your joints, right? So your images, you have an image of yourself, maybe a picture on your driver's license, a favorite picture of yourself that you have, what you see in the mirror in the morning and you shave or put on your makeup or whatever. So those are images. Then you have name, human being, Bob, person, male, American, alive, awake, etc. You have all kinds of labels. Are any of them the real, correspond to that real feeling like, I'm upset, you know. I'm full of being really me. Was that an image that felt that way? Do you have an image of exactly what that was? Do you have a name for exactly what that was? Well, you have the word self, which is kind of reflexive. You know, the table has a, you can say the table itself, the floor itself. Self just sort of seems to reflect to a thing to itself. A thing can also have a self, not just a person. So among ideas, I'm Bob Thurman, my name. Nowadays, I can be Tenzin Chodak, I can be Alexander, etc. I could change my name in a court. So if you go through your conceptual aggregate, your image and verbalization and image aggregate, pictorial and inner pictorial and verbalization aggregate, you process, you won't find something that fits with that real you feeling. But that's more subtle, so it takes more time and effort. But when you conclude that really carefully, you will feel that way. They say, I hope so. I can say that, I've had a little bit that feeling. Then you look at your emotions, sort of deeper structural elements of your consciousness, deeper functions in your consciousness. Like, for example, you have a sense of balance. You have a sense of up and down. You have a sense of direction. You have a sense of the passage of time. So it's almost something deeper than emotions, but also you do have a sense of outrage, you have a sense of desire, or you have a sense of frustration, you have a sense of envy, you have a sense of, you have emotions, you have self-confident, pride emotions. And they all are very shifting and various and multifarious. And it felt when someone insulted you and the real you was there feeling injured, it felt like it was an emotion about, I'm not like you say, I'm not like that. The I seemed to come from somewhere solid, but it's the emotion that it came with, was that it? You know, you go into that kind of analysis internally. And that's not too difficult either, because we can be easily pretty aware that our emotions and even our deeper structural ideas are very malleable, very fluctuating. And there are some wonderful experiments, actually, modern psychologists do. I never did it, actually. I wish I had that. You know, they say they've told me in their lab, they have a pair of glasses that you put on, a kind of lens. And when you put it on, your visual field flips upside down. And you see everything upside down. And within less than a minute, your brain flips it back over. And you can see through the thing and it flips it back. Which is a deep kind of visceral, you know, lesson in how much you construct your perception. And they use that in labs, you know. But I never did that. I never had that experience. Actually, I did have the experience without a lens when I met a certain Zen master once. The whole room went upside down for a short time. I was like that. I was completely normal. I hadn't had even a glass of wine or anything. Anyway, that's the emotional thing. Then finally, you come to consciousness, okay? Now then, when you get to consciousness, it can get very, very complex. I remember the first time that my root teacher, the Venerable Geshe-la, started teaching the Abhidharma to me. You know, the scientific, organized version of the Buddha's teaching. The wisdom basket, as they call it, in the, you know, the Abhidharma Pitaka, as they call it in the Pali Buddhism. And where you start thinking about, you start disassembling your sense of unity of consciousness. So you now are going to do that as in meditating form, okay? Okay, you're going to think now. Now you're, and this is why it's best to have your eyes half closed. And your two eyes, most you all have two eyes, I think. I have only one. You all have two eyes. And you're sort of focusing them on the, either the tip of your nose or a little bit in front of the tip of the nose with the eyelids half closed. It's the ideal way to meditate, rather than closing them or having them wide open. That's the ideal way. And the reason it's ideal is it's very boring. All you see is the tip of your nose or some little tiny boring thing like the back of the person sitting in front of you or the floor in front of you or whatever. And then a little bit you're aware of the eyelid. And so your visual field is really uninteresting, which is the point. So you're not just completely invested in being the recipient of visual images temporarily. That's why it's helpful to meditate. Okay? People who tell you, oh yeah, you can just close your eyes, they're just trying to make be go easy on you and let you rest a little. But that's not the good way to meditate, actually, traditionally. And these traditions are set by people who were great teachers of meditation and great meditators for thousands of years. So it's not like just somebody's opinion. I mean, it's many people's opinion. So you you go like that. Then you start to think, okay, an act of visual perception has three components. It has an object, something that seems to be out there. In my case, it's half a little bit out there and half sort of just on my eyelid. Perfect thing to note. So it's sort of half in and out. Then there's the optic nerve, what's registering the faculty, they call it the indriya, the organ, the visual organ, which is a material thing actually, subtle matter, you know, neurons, optic neurons. And then there's the consciousness itself, the visual consciousness, which registers, which somehow coordinates the contact between the object and the organ. So you can kind of break your visual perception into those three things. And then it gets even more complicated because you have had experiences where you were looking at something, but you were intently also listening to something, and you sort of didn't notice what was in front of your face visually because you were so intent on what you were listening. Or you can even be thinking something and not notice what you're visually seeing. You know, someone can be abstracted in a thought or a fantasy, and then someone's like waving hello, you know, in front of them, and they have to kind of attract their attention. I'm sure you've been in that kind of situation. You've had that experience, which means that your mental consciousness, what they call, which is a kind of more subtle organ, they have the various ways they define it. But the mental consciousness has to coordinate with the visual consciousness. In other words, pay attention to the visual consciousness, which registers the contact between organ and object. Okay? So normally we go around looking at things like it was a unitary, simple thing. We sort of automatically just responding to stimulus. But you see that there you can break it down into those three things. And then you have to add the witnessing activity of the mental consciousness, which decides to pay attention to the visual cognition, right? See if you can locate in yourself a little bit those things. Okay? So now you go to your hearing consciousness. Right now you're listening to my voice. So you, again, there's an organ, which is the audio nerve, we would call it. They call it a kind of subtle matter that's coating the eardrum. like atoms, they're made of atoms, you know, like very subtle matter. They have like a thing like that from ancient time. Then there's the reverberating sound, the wave in the air, right, which is the object. And then there's the audio consciousness that registers the contact of those two. And then there's the mental consciousness that pays attention to that registry. And it registers that moment of audio cognition. Okay, so there's another set of three there, right? Object, organ, and consciousness. Audio. Then the nose, sense of smell. Again, there's a object, which is an odor. Then there's this subtle matter coating the nasal mechanism, you know, up there on the cartilage somewhere. There's like some atoms, sensitive atoms that record odor, that contact the odor. Then there's the nose, olfactory consciousness. Again, three things. Then the mental consciousness has to connect to those three things by registering that the olfactory consciousness is registering the organ's perceiving of an odor. Okay? So you're getting, now you have another set of three things. Then you have the tongue. Not just the meat of the tongue, but the nerves on the tongue, which is the organ that registers the object of tastes. Then there's the taste consciousness. Then there's the mental consciousness that notes the registry by the taste consciousness of the contact between gustatory nerves, gustatory organ, tongue nerves, and taste. Substance that has a taste. Okay, another set of three. We're up to 12 things now. 4 times 3, right? Then you have tactile. You have textures. You have the nerves on the skin and some of the membranes inside. The different apertures. And then you have the consciousness of touch, the tactile consciousness, and then you have the mind paying attention to the tactile consciousness, which is, although it's, in a way, it's the coarsest of the five senses, it's the most pervasive, isn't it? It's your whole surface of your skin and some of the internal skin, right? So now you have 15 things. Then we have the mental consciousness has been operating with all 15, with all five of the different consciousnesses, right? Visual, audio, olfactory, gustatory, and tactile. And the mental has been hard at work. And then they say there's a mental organ, by analogy, and that all of those other consciousnesses are the mental object, you know, what the content of them, as well as the mind itself can fabricate an internal memory of smell, memory of a sight, memory of a sound, memory of a taste, memory of a touch. So it can reproduce in a field internally of mental objects. And they say the organ is actually not a physical thing, not a bunch of nerves, atoms resting somewhere, but it's the previous moment of experience. It's a complicated thing. So there you come up to 18 different factors operating in which you can break down yourself as a sensory and mental field with the inner and outer dimensions. Did you succeed in the 18 what are called elements or realms or dhatus? 18 elements, almost elements of experience, to succeed in the meditation. As I said, when my teacher first told me this Abhidharma, I felt dizzy. I had like a very, but it was kind of pleasant kind of dizziness. I didn't feel nauseous, but almost like things were spinning. Because I think what that spinning is that when you meditate that way and analyze yourself into your which normally I'm just going around doing smelling, seeing, tasting, touching, thinking, do you know what I mean? It's all one unitary thing, you know? So when you start taking it apart by examining it, like looking at the workings in a watch, you kind of lose that sense of the unitariness, habitual sense of the unitariness. Gets dizzy. Very, very helpful. Then somehow to rub it in, I guess, or for a certain type of person, they have what are called the 12 media. And this is sort of ignoring the organ part, or collapsing the organ in with the object, you know, of the 18. The 18 elements of experience, you have the 12 media of experience. Ayatana means some field within which things spread. So I like medium. I translate, some people translate it as, I think the old-fashioned translation was bases. But I don't think bases is good. It makes it overly solid, solidifies it. Medium is better. So you have the visual medium, visual consciousness medium, visual object medium, audio consciousness medium, audio object medium. You know, smell consciousness, smell object, taste consciousness, taste object, mind consciousness, mind objects. 12 rather than 18. All right? So, if you can concentrate to analyze your seemingly unitary experience into 5 aggregates, 18 elements of experience, and 12 media of experience, although you don't have to do them all at once, we're just running through them to get familiar with them, what happens is when you don't find anything in all of that, in the, you know, dealing with them one at a time. Anything in the 5, anything in the 18, anything in the 12. You don't really just do them all at once. When you do, when you don't find something in there, you are beginning to have a hinted experience of selflessness. Because you're looking for that thing that, you know, I'm really me here, which is why it sort of heats up. But even when you're not heated up, you're still feeling you're this unitary thing. You're really the real you going around doing this, doing that, doing the other. And it always seems like one lump. Okay? And this is mindfulness. Okay? This is wisdom practice. And it leads right into wisdom, into samadhi. When you already have a realistic worldview about the causal and interactive and relativistic nature of everything. And what you're looking for in the realistic worldview, where you have adopted the idea of that everything is a total relativity, when you become realistic and you accept causality, you're now looking at the experience you have as if there's something about you that's not causal, that's not relative, that's just you, irrespective of relation, independent of relation. And you're looking for, instead of just saying, okay, I believe it's not there, and then still viscerally feeling it's there, it would be useless. So instead, you become aware that you feel that there is a real you there, and then you look for it within these different schemas. And then if you don't find that in these very elaborate blueprints of your body-mind complex, you have an experience of freedom from such a thing. You have an experience of kind of melting into relativity. Yeah, the last experience before you really melt into relativity is where you feel that you melt out of relativity, actually. Life is so funny. And that's a big danger you don't want to think. Don't go that way, then that would be going the way of the self-centered nirvana, going the way of the separate nirvana, going the way of the Hindu nirvikalpa samadhi, thoughtless samadhi, going the way of the nihilist, seeking oblivion, seeking separation from all the bother, and thinking that's reality. And then you will get stuck in one of the four formless states. Infinite space, infinite consciousness, absolute nothingness, or beyond consciousness and unconsciousness. None of which Buddha sternly admonishes us from his own experience, none of which turn out to be nirvana, nibbana in the Pali. Okay? Okay, bing. My wife always tells me, don't leave people hanging meditating all the time, they'll pass out. So now you see, so he abides contemplating, talking about the mendicant, this Buddha, contemplating body as body internally, externally, and both internally, externally, and he abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. And that mendicant is how a mendicant abides contemplating body as body. And then, well, there's another one even. This is where this is still another way of dealing with the material, which we do in terms of anatomy, but he then says, a mendicant reviews the body in terms of the elements, and here he means the primary elements, earth, water, fire, wind, and space. They consider space an element. He talks about four here, actually, earth, water, wind, fire and wind. Try to find those components, and you can't, you know. But now you go, now we're going to do this one. Now mendicants, as if he were to see a corpse thrown in a charnel ground, one or two or three days dead, bloated, discolored, festering, and compares the mendicant's own body with that body, thinking, my body is of the same nature, it will become like that, it is not exempt from that fate. And so the mendicant abides contemplating body as body, internally, externally, both internally and externally, and abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. And that mendicant is how a mendicant abides contemplating body as body. Again, a mendicant as if he were to see a corpse in a charnel ground. We don't have these in the West. You know, they have them in India. Thrown aside, eaten by crows, hawks, or vultures, by dogs or jackals or various other creatures, compares this body with that. Think of a horror movie, you know, like, this body is of the same nature. I hate horror movies. I never watch them. But that's my own chicken behavior, you know. It will become like that. It is not exempt from that fate. Again, a mendicant, if you would see a corpse in a charnel gown thrown aside, a skeleton with flesh and blood connected by sinews, a fleshless skeleton smeared with blood connected by sinews, a skeleton detached from the flesh and blood connected by sinews, randomly connected bones scattered in all directions, a hand bone here, a foot bone there, them bones, a shin bone here, a thigh bone there, a hip bone here, a spine there, a skull there, compares this body with that. Thinking this body is of the same nature will become like that is not exempt from that fate. And each of those things mean that the original discourse, he went through the whole thing on each of those things that they have a dot, dot, dot on. God has like an incantation. Buddha's teaching of the meditation to the mendicants is like creating an meditation for them in his field, and therefore it has an incantatory quality. And they memorized that, and they remembered it for hundreds of years. When someone would grow old and nearly be facing, deciding to die soon, they would have five young people come and memorize it. And they really didn't memorize it. I mean, the Brahmins keep the Vedas like that. So they, in India, they were able to do that for sure. Then, this is the aggregates, which I just told you, and they insist on translating as feelings. But it's sensations. All it is pleasure and pain. And how mendicants does a monk abide contemplating sensations as sensations? Here a mendicant feeling a pleasant sensation knows that he feels a pleasant sensation. Feeling a painful sensation knows that he feels a painful sensation. Do you follow me? Why do they say feeling? Feelings means emotion to us. A lot. Oh, how are you feeling today? Oh, you hurt my feelings. It's an emotion. It's not really. Anyway, never mind. Sensual feeling, non-sensual feeling. Neither non-sensual, that is neither painful nor pleasant, nor that feels the non-sensual feeling, neither painful. Maybe that's because non-sensual. So they don't want to see sensation, non-sensual. I get it. I guess why they do it. Okay, I got it. So he applies and he goes, they go on and on about that. Now he jumps to mind as mind. But these are minds grasped by the addictions, the addictive states of mind. So they have jumped to mind. They didn't go through ideations, emotions. They jumped straight from sensations or feelings to mind. Okay. So these are the four foci of mindfulness. So they're not yet doing all of the aggregates, but they're going straight to mind. Okay. So these are different states of mind, right? Mind gripped by the addictions, the afflictions, the afflictive patterns, lust, hate, delusion, envy, pride, and then they're going into different kinds of meditative, feeling of being left behind, feeling of not being left behind, feeling concentrated, feeling unconcentrated, feeling liberated, and feeling unliberated. Mind like that. So then they do that mind, And then finally, mind objects. So then when you get to mind objects, they're looking at, it's like right now if you're meditating, you can see in your mind like your memory of yesterday, you can remember just now your sitting room at home, you can remember your experience 2 hours ago, you can remember all kinds of things. These are all mental objects in your mind. But he then immediately jumps to what are called the five hindrances to concentration, because he's using mindfulness to get at the next branch of the Eightfold Path, which is realistic concentration, samadhi. So desire, it makes a big thing about sensual desire, and ill will, that's hatred basically. But these are as hindrances. Then sloth and torpor. I love sloth and torpor. That's where you're passing out. Then worry and flurry. I also like a lot. Worry and flurry. Hullabaloo, worry and flurry. These are great words. And hullabaloo, that's a Hindi word. The English has a lot of Hindi words from the British occupation of India. Words like hullabaloo is a Hindi word. And these are related to the ancient Indian word worry and flurry. I forget what the original is, but it's like that. Worry and flurry is a good translation. Then doubt. And this doubt is kind of like crippling type of doubt, not critical analytic doubt, but just crippling doubt. Yes or no, and yes, no, So then again, seeing through all these mind objects, and then again, the unitary nature of the internal field of the inner theater of mind, as Wittgenstein would have called it, the mendicant sees through that. So he did it that way as the four foci of mindfulness. Now they go into the five aggregates. They go through the whole thing in aggregates, remember? Matter, but they call it form. But matter, feeling or sensation, perception or ideation, and then mental formations or emotions, and then finally consciousnesses, right? And then they go all through that. Then these are what they call sense bases. That's what I call the media, the 12, right? Visual object, visual consciousness, etc. We already did all this, so I'm just showing you that's that. And this is another bunch of things. These are positive. The seven factors of enlightenment are positive components of that. And so mindfulness itself, which is self-remembering. This is memory turned inward to the content of the processes of mind. So I think the Gurdjieffian word self-remembering is really better here than mindfulness, actually. But we know what mindfulness is, so that's what everybody uses. But self-remembering is what it is. So the enlightenment factor of self-remembering, self-awareness. So they do that. Then there's energy, but this just means effort, actually. It's kind of zeal. It's kind of enthusiasm. It's kind of wish to get something done in a spiritual way. Then there's a kind of delight at the process of being, you know, pursuing that zeal. Then there's a calmness about it when you, because you have to stay calm and focused, tranquility. Then that tranquility turns into real one-pointed concentration. And then finally, equality, which is really good, and that's different. Equanimity or equality is very important. And that means, you know, that's really good because that saves you as a factor of enlightenment, meaning a component of enlightenment, from going off on a self-centered state of separation. You know, once you think you get a one-pointed mind, you think, okay, my one-pointed mind is I'm looking for silence. I'm looking for space. I don't want all these differentiated discriminations. I want just open everything. I want open emptiness and silence. I want separation from all of the worry and flurry and hurry and bury and blooming, buzzing confusion, as William James called it. That's a great temptation for the sensitive spiritual person. But no, where you end is equality. When you have real concentration, you get equality. That means equality of self and other. That means equality of inside and outside. That saves you from disconnecting. Do you follow me? So right there in the individual vehicle where there is a kind of, he lets people have a kind of sense that they're going to escape, that they're going to get away from things into nirvana, but actually the seventh component of enlightenment or factor of enlightenment is equality, equanimity. Where one is aware of everything as equal to the self, to the selfless self. Then finally, Four Noble Truths. So this is enlightenment itself, you know, mindfulness, reaching toward, through combining with the seven factors of enlightenment. So when you're enlightened is when you really understand the Four Noble Truths, suffering, its origin, cessation, and the path. And he goes through that. And he goes through all the sufferings. They go through sadness, distress, attached to the unloved, separated from the loved, not getting what you want, getting what you don't want. And so then the five aggregates, they gain the five aggregates. That's the truth of suffering. Then the origin, again, he focuses on craving, but where does it arrive? Then all these six consciousnesses again, the contacts, the feelings, sensations, the motions, the volitions, he calls it. Finally, the cessation, nirvana. It is the complete fading away and extinction of this craving. It's forsaking and abandonment, liberation from it, detachment from it. And how does this craving come to be abandoned? How does its cessation come about? Wherever in the world there's anything agreeable and pleasurable, there its cessation comes about. And what is there in the world that is agreeable and pleasurable? The eye, the ear, the tongue, the body, the mind. There its cessation comes about. There its cessation. So, you know, cessation sounds so awful. Being, in other words, all of this whole complex, everything within the things themselves, not by withdrawing from them, all of them become free from anything irritating. All of the contact, tangible, everything. That's the cessation. So that's so great. That's so important. The nirvana is already, right there is non-duality here in what we call dualistic Buddhism, in that he's still entertaining, letting them entertain the idea that nirvana will be an escape from all of this. But he's saying that you escape being within it. You escape within the thoughts, you escape within the consciousnesses, within the will powers, within the perceptions, within the contacts, sense contacts. The cessation comes about in all of those. So what they could read that, they think, oh yeah, that means I won't have any. I won't have any sense contact. Or it means that I'll be having them, and yet there'll be a cessation of suffering in the having of them. So there's two ways of understanding that. And he lets them understand it like, I won't be having it, I won't be seeing, I won't be thinking, I won't be doing that. So then finally we have the path. And again, they're using right? Remember, and I like to use realistic. But right is not wrong. And what is the right view, realistic view, is wisdom itself, of course, which is therefore the first branch of the path. It's knowledge, you see, of suffering, knowledge of the origin, knowledge of freedom from suffering or cessation of suffering, knowledge of the way, that's the realistic view. So it goes beyond just causation here, when it's realized at this moment of realizing it. Thought of renunciation, the thought that's non-craving, renunciation means, that's for the layperson, that's the shifting of priorities. Renunciation is not going and becoming a mendicant, necessarily, for a layperson, and especially in a society where there's no support, really, for mendicants. But in a barbarian borderland, what they would call a borderland society, such as the US of A, because they won't support mendicants here. They won't even give you scholarships in school anymore. So, hardly. So, but it's, the renunciation is what I like to translate as transcendent renunciation, or transcendence. It's a shifting of priorities. It's adopting a life purpose that you as a human being have the chance to attain nirvana or some sort of orientation toward nirvana. And that, you know, true understanding of the way your mind is, or the way your mind works, and going beyond, attaining non-ill will, you have no malice toward anyone, with malice toward none, no thought of violence or harmfulness to anyone. Harmlessness means non-violence, the same word, ahimsa. This monk is called right thought, but, you know, right motivation in life. It's beyond just thought. That's not very good. Right speech. This is the four ethical things of speech. No lying, no slander, which means, particularly slander means saying bad things about others to make them enemies with each other. So it's really backbiting. You could slander someone where you weren't intending on having someone else dislike them. Well, I guess you always think you want someone else to dislike them. Maybe slander's okay. Okay, and refraining from harsh speech and refraining from frivolous, but frivolous is literally meaningless. You know, like pointless, called right speech, realistic speech, right action, focusing on the physical here, evolutionary action, killing, stealing, sexual misconduct. Then right livelihood, which he doesn't elaborate here, but it means like being a butcher, a killer, a soldier, an assassin, a thief, you know, taking what is not given, literally. So there's various ways of there being, you could be a legal thief. Like that Wells Fargo executive. Elizabeth Warren really gave it to him, but I don't think she's able to arrest him. She said he should be, but I don't think she could. That's pathetic. So here, right effort, that's arouses his will, makes an effort, stirs up energy, exerts the mind, strives to prevent the arising, blah, blah, you know, to do all these things. So it's arousing, it's an arousal of effort. It's basically effort. Diligence is another possible translation. To maintain wholesome states, not to let them fade away. I like the word creativity, actually. Spiritual creativity. That's realistic spiritual creativity. Then mindfulness, there's the whole sutra on mindfulness, we've done that. Contemplating the body as body, ardent, clearly aware and mindful. Having put aside hankering and fretting for the world, he abides contemplating feelings as feelings, mind as mind, etc. This is right mindfulness and right concentration. It goes beyond that, and then you start entering into the four contemplative states, the four immeasurables. The first dhyana, which he calls just the first contemplative state, the jhana. But this is the same as the first immeasurable, both in Theravada and Mahayana, and that's the love immeasurable. So when you enter that, when you become concentrated, you go into the form realm, you have a feeling, or your body feels like it's expanded, you're not identifying with the same differentiated body of the sense fields, you have an inner sense field, you have an inner faculty, like a new different body, a spiritual body, which is still reflective, thinks verbally, analyzes, but feels transcendent and joyful and delighted at having feeling transcendence. And then when you stop thinking so much and get less verbalizing, you get greater inner tranquility and oneness of mind, you reach the second dhyana, which is called immeasurable compassion, which means that in that dhyana, to have love and compassion, of course, you have to remain aware in these inner states. People think you're severing yourself from them, but you're not. You're even more aware of all beings, but you're sort of aware and not aware at the same time. It's more complex, or you wouldn't call it immeasurable love and compassion, because the love means you're feeling an overwhelming inner joy that wants to automatically flow to all beings. So you're aware that all you arising in this form realm, you see, in that way of the stratification of the mental physical world in the Buddhist science, when you're at any higher level, you're completely aware of all the lower levels. Like if you're in the desire realm heaven, when you're in the highest one, remember the highest one? The next highest one is the one where you enjoy any fantasy that you can possibly have. It's like full enjoyment, the fantasy. You don't have to have any deal with anybody because you're just having fantasies. And then you're so jaded at the top of the sense desire realm that you don't even have any fantasies anymore. So you're a voyeur on all the lower beings' experiences of pleasure. That is still in the realm of sense desire. So when you go beyond that into the first love thing, you have this inner love and joy in the first dhyana. That's why they call it immeasurable love. And there are three planes there of where there are a lot of deities of people who thought that was the absolute and then became deities of that plane. Okay, left their human body, just left it. Was it too boring to go back to? Because it's such a much more powerful, where your whole field is this delight and joy. But then the delight and joy, and the delight at having the joy, the delight means kind of, the delight and joy sort of subsides and it's just the joy flowing and you're not thinking about anything, but you're completely aware of all the beings who are suffering and therefore you feel compassion. You feel so powerfully joyful, you want to like sort of suck out all the suffering out of all beings. That's why it's called immeasurable compassion. You know, it's not like you think I want to do that. It's just that you just draw it up. It seems to dissolve to you, to the field, the powerful Brahma body, the field that you have. Because you have like a Brahma body, a divine field embodiment, rather than a limited, skin-limited, you know, like desire realm embodiment. Then, with the feeling fading away of delight, so you're no longer thrilled that this is happening, you just feel so good, remaining imperturbable, mindful and clearly aware of everything, you experience in himself the joy of which the noble ones say, happy is he who dwells, or joyful is he who dwells with equanimity and mindfulness. And he enters the third dhyana, which is called immeasurable joy. Immeasurable joy, mudita, apramana. And where does the joy come? The immeasurable joy comes because one is getting very close to enlightenment here, and one no longer feels the need to suck out the suffering of the beings, because one is beginning through wisdom to see through the beings whose suffering is caused by their delusion and craving and aggression and ill will, and beginning to see that the beings have in their sort of cells, in their inner fibers, in the inner light that makes them, that is their real vitality, although they are scrambling around in the suffering state, but what they're scrambling around in the suffering state with is made of a kind of bliss and joy. So that's called immeasurable joy, and it's expressed as, and the state of immeasurable joy is like, may all beings enjoy the kind of joy that doesn't harm them, that is sort of natural in them, so therefore they don't crave it because they have it. Although when they're feeling all frustrated, they want something else, they don't even notice that they have it. But even the energy with which they want something else, or they feel frustrated, or they feel angry, itself comes from the fact that their very togetherness of their atoms if you will, of their cells, of their flesh and blood, is joyful. So that's why it's immeasurable joy. And then, having given up, then he says, and having given up pleasure and pain, and with the disappearance of former gladness and sadness, in other words, sort of relative dependent types of pleasure and pain, some, you know, from somebody else, the mendicant enters and remains in the fourth dhyana, which is called immeasurable equanimity, which is beyond pleasure and pain, meaning that kind of circumstantial pleasure and pain, and purified by equanimity and mindfulness. And this is called realistic concentration, samadhi. And that, monks, is called the way of practice leading to the cessation of suffering, but it's still not nirvana. But it's the fourth dhyana, but it's the place from which nirvana is attained. It's the realm of Brahma, actually. Where there are seven heaven planes in that immeasurable equanimity. So then they go back to the whole thing, back to mind objects arising. That's called mind objects. And then four foundations of mindfulness is not a good training. Four foci of mindfulness. Foci of self-awareness. Foci of self-remembering. Whoever mendicants should practice these four foci of mindfulness for just 7 years, they expect one of two results. Either arhatship in this life, that means nirvana, or if there should be some substrate left of the sort of ignorant, delusion-driven craving at the instinctual level, which indeed there might be, the state of a non-returner, let alone 7 years, then he goes, whoever practices that for 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, they expect one of them, 7 months, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 month, I don't know, half a month. Oops, 2 weeks. Whoever should practice the four foci of mindfulness is just 1 week. They expect one of these two results, either arhatship in this life, or if there should be some substrate left, that means instinct, the state of a non-returner. Thus it was said, there is, monks, this one way to the purification of beings, for the overcoming of sorrow and distress, for the disappearance of pain and sadness, for the gaining of the right path, for the realization of Nibbana. That is to say, the four foci of self-remembering, or foundations of mindfulness, and it's for this reason that it was said. Thus the Lord spake, and then thus spake Zarathustra, thus spake the Bhagavan, and the monks rejoiced and were delighted at his words. The mendicants rejoiced and were delighted at his words. It's really cool, isn't it? So now, let's see. Well, yeah, we have some time. I want to go to the Pali Nibbana Sutta in this context now that we all almost practically attained Nirvana ourselves. I think it's page 235. I remember from looking at the 232. 2, 3, 16. Okay, I'm sorry. Don't look. You'll be dizzy. Meditate on the evanescence of visual objects. 274. You know, when he himself, their description of him attaining nirvana, final nirvana or thorough nirvana, Buddha's last days. 234. Oh yeah, that should be it. 235, oh no. Maybe it wasn't 235. It's the beginning. Well, actually, oh yeah, I don't need this part. It's the early part of that sutra, you know, sutta where, you know, there's this thing where poor Ananda, he gets distracted by the devil when Buddha hints that a Buddha can live as long as he likes, hundreds of years if necessary. In some worlds, Buddhas are always there. And then Ananda gets distracted by Mara, and he doesn't ask, oh, please stay longer. And then Buddha does that 3 times, and he gets distracted each time, and he doesn't ask. So then Buddha says, okay, I'm going now, I'm 81, I've had enough. And Ananda didn't ask. And that's why Ananda gets thrown out of after Buddha does pass, he gets thrown out by the leader of the... Okay, now he's going on, but there's a lot of great things about sort of final advice of the Buddha, but we don't have time. I want to come back to the meditative thing. And he purposely ate some food that was poisoned, some kind of weird truffle or something, but that had spoiled, and he knew it was poisonous because he had it buried. He wouldn't have let anybody else eat it. And another thing I wanted to do before I left the Theravada was Pali Suttas, sort of to prepare you for the shock of the Mahayana Sutras, Sanskrit ones, is, you know, look at this, you know, you hear Buddha saying, in whatever realm the wise man makes his home, he should feed the virtuous leaders of the holy life. Whatever gods there are, they always put devas, because they're nervous to say gods. But deva just means gods. Whatever gods there are who report this offering, they will pay him respect and honor for this. So Buddhism is full of gods. He talks to them, he teaches them, he goes to heaven and teaches them. They come down and study with him at night. Poor guy never gets to sleep. The monks go to sleep and he goes to his hut, and then the gods come and say, oh, I'm worried, I'm going to fall, I'm not going to be a god anymore, teach me something. Constantly going on like that. So he gives lots of things, and he keeps going here. I want to see his actual meditative thing. Mirror of Dhamma. Then Amrapali, one of his, Amrapali, remember Ambapali, they call him Pali, but her name is Amrapali. One who has the mango fruit, who is like a mango fruit. Famous, she's like, he was like a, you know, movie star, Marilyn Monroe of the time, from the great city of Vaishali, where Vimalakirti lived, but he's not mentioned here. And these young Lichavis came. They're very magnificent. It was a super wealthy city. And he, Buddha loves them, he praises them. They look like gods, don't they? Like the 33 gods. And that's an incident that Vimalakirti connects to, which we will read next. But he's going to make a statement. Live as islands, you know. Then the Lord, here we go. No, he's going to our alms now, and they never get there. And then Mara comes and says, hurry up and attain Nirvana. Pass away. Then he restrains his whole life to Ananda. Eight liberations. It's quite great. Okay. But he says, first he's just saying this. And Mara constantly is asking him every time, like, to die, you know. Mara doesn't like him teaching people. Oh, God. I don't want him in Vaishali. Go to Kusinagara. Okay, here we go. Then the Lord adopted the lion posture, which is lying on your right side, your head propped up so it's not crunching on the shoulder, and with your hands like this in front of you and your legs that way. So it's like a lion lying on its side. That's the best sleeping posture, they say. Because when you lie on the right side, the heart doesn't have the weight of the bigger lung lying on top of it. So the heart is in a comfortable place. Oh, no, he's going to, this guy's talking to him. I'm sorry. Oh, still traveling, I'm sorry. Also, he had the food now that's going to be, and then he's talking about the gods who are going to come, and has a little, they have a discussion about what to do with the body, creates the pilgrimage places, he says, divide my relics after my body is gone, when it's burned, put it in four stupas. And then it's a terrible place he goes to, Kusinara, finally here. But then there's another sutta where he says this was, he was once a universal monarch in that place. He has a huge thing about it. Oh, God. Last student. Subhadra. Okay, then the Lord said to the monks, "Now, monks, I declare to you," this is the last words, "all conditioned things are of a nature to decay. Strive on entirely." These were the Tathagatas. And Tathagata, remember I told you that that means one who has gone to the transcendent. Tathata, to suchness. So final enlightenment. Then the Lord entered the first dhyana. Okay, we already went through, that's why I wanted to connect this. I'm sorry I had so much time, spent so much time. The Lord entered the first dhyana, right? Immeasurable love. And leaving that, he entered the second. And then the third, then the fourth dhyana. Immeasurable compassion, immeasurable joy, immeasurable equanimity. Then, leaving the fourth dhyana, he entered infinite space. He says sphere, you know, state, medium. It's called ayatana, which is again the word medium. Medium doesn't really convey necessarily a physical volume thing, because this is a mental. So there's no sense of volume here. Mass is infinite, precisely infinite space. The sense of objective mass becomes infinite. This past the speed of light is what that is. So therefore, there's only the body is only light in this state. Sphere of infinite consciousness. You know, then the consciousness spreads through that sphere, through that medium. Seems to spread through it, but it's not a volume again. So then it all becomes conscious, this vastness, this infinite light. Then the sphere of, then the light becomes sort of too dazzling. Then it goes into darkness, sphere of no-thingness, like as if you became obliterated and went into oblivion. But then that feels confining, because your consciousness knows it's not nothing without thinking about it. So then the sphere of neither consciousness nor unconsciousness, which is said to be like a gray kind of, it's like neither dark nor light, neither conscious or unconscious. And then in leaving that, he attained the cessation of feeling and perception. Okay? That's the thing I said earlier, you find in sutras saying, don't attain it at the wrong time. So then Ananda wrongly thought, and he spoke to Anuruddha, who was a much more enlightened than him, better meditator. He said, "Anuruddha, the Lord has passed away." But Anuruddha says, Anuruddha means unstoppable, by the way, non-ceasing. "No, friend Ananda, the Lord has not passed away. He has only attained the cessation of feeling and perception." That's an even stronger place of obliteration than the four formless states. That then they tend to think that the dualistic people who understand Buddhism dualistically tend to think that nirvana is even beyond that, like a tenth state. But look, leaving the attainment of the cessation of feeling and perception, entered the medium of neither perception nor non-perception. Okay, the fourth formless state. From that he entered the medium of nothingness, the third formless state. From that he entered the medium of infinite consciousness, the second formless state. And from that he entered the sphere of infinite space, where mass became infinite, so there's no mass. He's everywhere. But then he leaves that and he goes to the fourth contemplation of equanimity. Then he descends from that to the third one. So that's infinite equanimity, immeasurable equanimity. Not infinite anymore, it's called immeasurable, because there is some sort of body there. From there the third, immeasurable joy. From there the second, immeasurable compassion. And then the first, immeasurable love. Whoops, was he going back to the desire realm? No. Then from immeasurable love, the first dhyana, again, he goes back to the second, immeasurable compassion. Then the third, immeasurable joy. Then the fourth, immeasurable equanimity. And leaving the fourth dhyana, he then leaves the body, which of course, eventually you'll see in a later class, in tantric science, super subtle subconscious science means clear light. He enters clear light. Because death is defined, passing away is defined as the mind going into clear light and leaving a coarse body. So that's the death of the coarse body. So that's his, but the clear light is infinitely present everywhere. It's in hell as well as in the highest formless heaven. So that means attain Buddhahood, which is a bliss, void, indivisible unity with the clear light, which is everywhere, Dharmakaya, not apart from everything. And the word pari, as I think I said, pari nibbana, the word pari doesn't mean final, it's not a temporal word, it means thorough, it means complete, total. So he entered total nirvana, meaning he entered where the dharmakaya, you know, is everything. So he is one with everything in all of its differentiated condition, without ignoring its differentiated condition. That's really critical. But you later in the tradition of the individual vehicle, the commentators and people tend to consider that cessation of feeling and perception, this one, you see, he left the sphere of neither perception nor non-perception, and leaving that attained the cessation of feeling and perception, sort of like the ultimate isolation. And beyond that is Nibbana. You find that happens. And people think people sort of totally disappear, even that kind of subtle. They already disappeared in the nothingness state. Then they went beyond disappearing, and they were appearing and disappearing at the same time. Then they went into don't feel or perceive anything, which is sort of like almost like regressing to the nothingness thing, but he's just rubbing it in. The Buddha's rubbing it in to try to clue people to stop trying to escape from the world. And in a self-centered way. Don't mistake a feeling of complete abstraction and total isolation as nirvana. Nirvana has to be spread throughout everything to be the genuine Buddha nirvana. And he totally teaches that here. In Pali, by the way this is described, and Ananda thinks what the ordinary self-centered person still thinks. This world is so much suffering that you must have to disappear from this world to attain nirvana. But Anuruddha says, no, he hasn't. He's just shown that you can attain a kind of disappearance, no feeling, no perception, but you're not finished. Your continuum continues. So you have to non-dually have a sense of total freedom and be through wisdom and total engagement through compassion. So you say, no breathing in and out, just with a steadfast heart. The sage who's free from that, from lust, has passed away to peace. With mind unshaken, he endured all pains. By Nibbana, the illumined mind is freed. And then Ananda freaks out, and a lot of the monks freak out. You know, then there's a whole story about dividing the relics and everything. They almost have a war about it. They're so much fun with the Buddha. And his body has a lot of like pearls and weird jewels when they burn it. And some modern people also do, some modern enlightened people. Okay. So that's Pali Buddhism. We did that. I'm gonna read in the Vimalakirti. We're gonna move to Mahayana, Universal Vehicle Buddhism, next week. And so a lot of you have already read it, I think. How many of you have already read the Vimalakirti Sutra? Wei Mo Jing. It's called the Wei Mo Jing, Vimalakirti Arya Mahayana Sutra. Any questions? We have 15 minutes. Any questions? There's a mic here. Okay.
Hi, Professor Thurman. Could you clarify this point? I may have misunderstood you.
I'm going to have to, microphone or not, I'm coming over here. Yes?
Okay. What? I think you had said that arhats are reborn as form realm gods.
That's what the Mahayana people say.
So I was wondering, because I thought arhats were already free of samsara, and form realm.
That's still, what they think, too.
Yeah. Oh. Okay.
And there is one arhat who's free from samsara. That's the Buddha.
Yeah.
But And in a way, they're free from any unpleasant part of the samsara, but the form realms, deities are in samsara.
Right. But
so, and all nirvana is in samsara. That's their problem is they think that enlightenment is freedom from samsara, whereas enlightenment has to encompass samsara. Parinirvana means total nirvana, that is making all samsara nirvana. You see, without leaving it. That's according to the Mahayana. And that we can, and actually it's arguable, and probably the majority of Theravada Pali Buddhist people until the 9th century or 10th century, time of Duttagamani, when they first started their war with the Tamils, actually. until then, most of the monastic Buddhists, the individual vehicle Buddhists, embraced the Mahayana ideology, mostly. You know, they didn't do things like they do nowadays, where they act like, oh, Mahayana is not really the real thing, you know. Something made up, some imitation of Hinduism, which is what they will say, maybe some of the very orthodox people in Sri Lanka will say, or Burma, or Thailand, they will say that. Although they're kind of warming up to it now, because they have these Buddhist fellowship meetings, and they meet people from Japan, and China, and Tibet, and Mongolia, and things, and they're kind of a little bit hedging their bets nowadays, getting a little less stuck. But some of them are still very stuck.
But even in Mahayana, isn't there the idea that, you know, on the path of seeing,
once the what?
On the path of seeing.
Yeah, path of seeing, yes.
Once you realize that, isn't there the understanding that you are then free of samsara, even in Mahayana?
That you've left samsara from the path of seeing, or are you saying that? No way. That's no.
No.
No, the path of seeing. Then you go to the path of meditation with 81 levels. And the Theravada also has the five paths, by the way. Path of accumulation, path of preparation, path of, or application, path of seeing, path of meditation, and no more learning path. And there's so many levels. You know, enlightenment is so vast.
No, but liberation. Isn't liberation freedom from samsara on the path of seeing?
No, but see, that's the dualistic thing, which, you know, they can still argue it, of course. They can still argue that. They can say, oh yeah, I just disappeared and that's why I'm going there and I'm going back there when I die. They can still feel that, even though Buddha, he passed away from the body at the place in the top of the form realm where the highest gods are. And actually in Mahayana cosmology, that's where the Buddha lands are, you know, where Amitabha, you know, like etc., you know, Sukhavati, all of these Buddha verses. And Shakyamuni doesn't have a separate Buddha verse because this here now is Shakyamuni's Buddha verse. We'll see this in the Vimalakirti. So he didn't pass away from here. Shakyamuni is still here, actually. He said to the monks, oh yeah, I'm here in the Dharma. So then the dualist Buddhists who are desperate to get away from this mess, they could say, oh yeah, that means the text or the teachings, he's here. But the Dhamma means reality itself. The teaching would not be useful if it wasn't leading one to the method, if it wasn't the method of achieving reality. And why would you want to achieve reality if reality is if samsara is real over here, and nirvana is real over here, and you have to get out of this reality? On contrary, the reality of samsara is nirvana. But that means that the reality of something is the thing itself. It's not the reality of the thing is not when the thing is gone. The reality of the thing is the actual nature of samsara, is nibbana. So you realize that, and then you're still here, and you see every other being as also equally like you in nibbana, like that's the realm of immeasurable equanimity, which incorporates within it love, compassion, and joy. Right? Because when you go through those four dhyanas, each one higher up contains the lower one. So you're equal with all other beings. You see all other beings as totally nirvana, apparently. Buddha does. And then simultaneously, they see, oh, I don't, what do you mean? I'm not in nirvana. I'm really frustrated. I'm very angry. Oh, I'm in hell. I'm whatever. Then your compassion, then that immeasurable compassion level functions. Oh, the reality of you, you're like the doctor. The reality of you is bliss and you are miserable. So what's the method to heal that? So you find your own health, which is your reality. The Four Noble Truths are a prescription, recognition of a symptom, diagnosis of the cause, prognosis of the cure, and therapy to get to the cure, right? It's not a theory, the Four Noble Truths. It's not a dogma, a doctrine. So the text in which that's stated is not the Buddha's presence. The Buddha's everywhere, indivisible from all of the beings. He's the mother. We're in the Buddha's womb, right here and now. And he's giving the hint to that by not attaining nirvana from the cessation of feeling and perception. Beyond the most formless, so like he would say to the Hindus, well, I go way beyond your nirvikalpa samadhi that you people, you Brahmins, are so desperate to get out of here. Especially male Brahmins, because they just don't want to go to that kitchen. You know, they do not want to go back to the kitchen. They do not want to wash the dishes, cook the food, prepare it, etc. They want to just be fed. Right? And then ultimately they want out. Another question. Is that okay? That answers the question? So, but I mean, they can make the argument. And then the mind-only Mahayana types, you know, the idealists, what they're called Vijnanavadas or Chittamatras, they say the Arhats are just foolish. They're selfish. They don't know anything. They're psychos, you know. But the Prasangika, the Madhyamakas, and especially the Prasangikas, but all of the Madhyamakas, they say, oh no, the Arhats are truly enlightened. It's just they don't have the compassion side of the enlightenment. They're enlightened like a god, you know, and they're in touch with that nirvana. But then to get from where they sort of know that nirvana's there fully and enlightened in that way to there, because they have burned out their kind of emotional connectedness, their compassion, everything, they're so focused on being apart from everything, they're so aloof. It takes a really long time in their non-returning place, where they don't get reborn in our human way, where we're more kind of flesh and blood, you know, we're interwoven, interconnected. You know? I had a kind of a epiphany one time when I was talking with a Christian guy, actually. What's his name? I forgot his name. He's a disciple of that great father, the environmentalist guy who was banned by the old Vatican. I forgot his name. Father, and I forgot the name of this other guy, too. I'm sorry. But anyway, he was talking about why he had his own way of trying to connect Genesis to the Big Bang, you know, sort of make it a scientific thing. And then I was thinking, and then he wanted me to make some parallels about Buddhism. But I didn't go into the Aganya Sutta with him. But I suddenly realized that I myself, and all of us, why wouldn't we stay in the realm beyond conception and non-conception, like Turiya? Why wouldn't we just, it's so troublesome. There's so much stress in life, you know. If we ever got disembodied, and yet conscious, why wouldn't we stay there? And then I realized that you really get stuck there, you know, because there's no interaction with anybody. And so they say it's a tremendous trap. You stay there for billions of, for aeons, kalpas, because you don't want to leave there. And that's why there is a bodhisattva called Akasha Garbha, which means the womb of space. And he goes in these formless states, bodiless places, but somehow he has something like a cattle prod, but a mental cattle prod. And he pokes people out of there. I don't know how he does it, but that's his special job, you know. Like Chittigarbha, the bodhisattva called the essence, the womb of earth, or the essence of earth, his thing is going and emptying people out of hell. That's his job, you know, among the bodhisattva jobs. But Akasha Garbha goes in these sort of space states and he prods people out of there. I don't know how he lures them out. And I was thinking when I was listening to this guy, it was really kindly because I remembered, I somehow had a sense of memory. I mean, not really, because I don't really remember them. But I had a sense of like, I must have been stuck there a long time once in the infinite, because we've all been everywhere, you know, in infinite path. But I really viscerally felt I must have been there, hiding out from everything. And it connects in my own biography with my blessed, original root teacher, a Mongolian geshe, who used to interrupt me when I was meditating. And then he skipped the verses on samadhi and dhyana, on the four dhyanas, in Nagarjuna's book, which he first read me in Tibetan, which is how I learned the language. I was so excited about it. Everything I read was like jumped off the page in golden letters to my mind. But then he skipped that verse. Then I'd be meditating away. And anytime I was about to sort of leave the body, I would come into like a, because I guess I had affinity from previous life, I would be about to get really abstracted. He would show up, knock on the door, let's go have yoga. What are you doing? Why aren't you sleeping? He would just totally bother me. So then I finally ran off in the woods in New Jersey there behind some pine tree and tried to meditate. And he still found me. What are you doing out here? Are you freaking out? He had a clairvoyance about my state of mind. And I think because I would have gone into maybe some cessational type thing and become really addicted to quietism, and it kind of paralyzes your ability to learn. I know people who've done a lot of meditating, Zen and otherwise, and it's all, they're very calm and very concentrated. And then, you're talking to them about something, or they look at a book, and they go like, and they look up at you, and words are so cumbersome. Their kind of ability to think critically, to learn, is like paralyzed. Because they're just too much trouble. The divisions and discriminations and differentiation. And they've been taught a definition of enlightenment as like an empty mind. As I said, the shout of Buddha under the tree should have been, duh. If that was the case. Yes. Another question.
I had a question.
You want to?
Would like to comment about the Arhat.
Yeah, about the Arhat, yes.
I'm from Thailand. And
yes. Yeah, okay.
I don't think the Arhat think that they are fall in the fall break. Because they understand that it was fall.
They don't think that?
No. Arhat.
Yeah.
From Theravada, Thailand.
Yes.
They don't think that they're in the fall break. Because they separated into three, the desire limb and form limb and formless limb.
Yeah.
And Arhat was outside of these three.
All three?
Outside.
Yeah, but how would you get outside of all three? That would be like beyond cessation, wouldn't it? If you read the Buddha's own Parinibbana Sutta in Pali, which they read those Arhats, he doesn't leave the form. If since you're leaving the realm of non-perception, the formless, that at least you left the body there, then you leave the mind. Then you're really gone. But Buddha doesn't do that.
Exactly.
He comes to the form realm, the boundary between form and formless, and then his mind, his Buddha mind, expands to encompass the whole universe.
Yes, correct.
Yes. He doesn't leave the universe.
No,
but the Arhats think they do. Precisely.
No.
Yes, they do. They think they leave it. That's precisely what I call a dualistic Buddhism. They think they leave. They don't need the world. They're gone. Meanwhile, they need to be fed until they die. Then when they physically die, then they've gone from the world. Never come back.
Oh. After they die, Arahat, they will be disappear. So you agree?
Yes.
You agree that they're not in the form limbs? That you agree?
No, I don't agree. I don't agree.
But they think.
They think they're going to disappear.
They disappear.
So they think being disappeared is the ultimate condition. And let me ask you this.
Yes.
Let me ask you this. Yes. Isn't there something selfish about that?
Yes.
Don't you think there's something selfish about that? I disappeared. Forget about you. You're still suffering. No. You live in New York City. You're not in Thailand having nice Thai food. You're living in New York with the horrible hamburgers. And I'm gone, though. Bye for you. Bye. I don't care about you, that means. I'm leaving. That's selfish. You think Buddha is selfish?
I don't think that it's selfish, but that you're wrong about it, because there are two kinds of Arahat now. In Thailand, there are another Theravada who are arguing with this arahat type, okay? This is a new thinking.
Who?
Absolutely. It's the Mahaya. There's a new type, new movement.
Oh, you mean there's a Mahayana movement in Thailand?
Absolutely. They're born in Thailand, Theravada.
Yeah, but you know before...
Listen,
Let me tell you something.
Yes.
1,000 years ago, there was Mahayana in Thailand.
Yes, that's true.
But then in Sri Lanka, they destroyed the one of the big monasteries, I forgot the name, one, there's the Mahavihara and the... I forgot that there was a different Vihara that was Mahayana. And then they destroyed one king, two kings fighting. One was Mahayana, one was not. They killed the king, Mahayana king, and they destroyed that monastery. Then suddenly Sri Lanka said, no, we're not going to do Mahayana anymore. Then they went to Thailand and Burma, and they also destroyed Mahayana. So it isn't, if there's a new movement in Thailand, it's just a repeating of the old movement.
No. This is a new movement. I don't think.
But it's coming
really
back to the old movement.
That in Thailand, yeah, there's all kind of movement, and monks themselves don't really follow strictly this. Okay, some people are practice and they believe. This is a huge fighting and conflict in Thailand. One movement is that arahat or whatever, they are not distinct, and they're expanding exactly like Mahayana.
The what? Like the Mahayana,
yes,
you're saying.
They exist, okay? They exist, and they have this mind expansion, exactly what you just said.
Yeah, but like, that's not...
This is a new
movement. Well, okay, I understand what you're saying, but wait a minute. The Mahayana doesn't dislike the arhat. One branch does, the mind-only school. They act like the arhats are deluded. But the Madhyamaka school, the more important one, says the arhats are very enlightened, but they have a further step to go, that's all.
Mm-hmm.
So they do respect the arhat. It's not they don't respect.
I know.
But the arhat who acts like, I'm like just as good as Buddha, then they would criticize that arhat.
They respect
the arhat, real arhat. But the final arhat is only Buddha. Arihata, the one who really has conquered the enemy of selfishness, is only Buddha. And all arhats are going to be Buddha, just like you and I are going to be Buddha.
No, but I'm trying to clarify.
But if there's a movement in Thailand today, I'm sorry. If there's a movement in Thailand today
that
says that it's something better than arhat, and then it's bad to the individual vehicle Buddhists, the Pali Buddhists, that's not good. In other words, with them and says they're bad and
that's
they're...
That's not right.
That's not good.
There's a fighting about this.
They shouldn't fight.
No, you don't understand Thailand. There's a distinct or not distinct. That the arahat said after being arahat, they're distinct, extinct, okay? And another movement said not extinct.
Oh, well, that's like Mahayana agrees with
exactly.
that.
Exactly. So they're born with in Theravada.
Yeah, but do they use Mahayana scriptures? Do they read Mahayana sutras?
No.
So therefore, they're not real Mahayana. If they did, they would read Mahayana scriptures.
But they come out with this idea by themselves.
But you know, there's a very interesting thing, which when I used to give talks at Buddhadasa's place in Thailand, in Bangkok. You know, they invite
Buddha
me.
Dasa, yes.
Buddhadasa has
yes.
archive there, uh-huh. And I used to go there and give talks.
Okay.
You know, I say anytime I go to Thailand, they invite me and I go give a talk.
Right.
But then one thing, then thinking about them, and some monks even come. You know, some mendicant bhikkhus, and I talk with them. But one thing that really interests me, for 1,000 years, the Mahayana Sutras were, you know, worshipped and studied, etc., in many monasteries throughout all India, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Burma, everywhere, right? For 1,000 years, once Mahayana came on top of Theravada and Mahasanghika,
mm-hmm.
and it empowered Mahasanghika and Theravada, made it stronger, actually. Mm-hmm. The Mahayana did. It didn't weaken it made it mm-hmm. stronger. So there was not real conflict, mm-hmm. except for a few individuals who said, oh, I don't want that Mahayana.
Mm-hmm.
There were some individual monks like mm-hmm. that. And yet, the proof that the acceptance by most of the Pali monks in India and Sri Lanka and everywhere of Mahayana is, nobody ever translated a Mahayana Sutra from Sanskrit into Pali.
Yeah.
There's not one translation of Mahayana Sutra over those 1,000 years that anybody has discovered it anyway. Maybe someone will find one day. You never want to say never. Mm-hmm. But there's no translation, even short sutra, into Pali. Mm. Now, this either means that the Pali reading monks, you know, memorizing monks, could just read the Sanskrit and didn't need to translate it because they're very similar. Or it means that they just enjoyed reading the Sanskrit and then they also had their memorized Pali text. Do you follow me? Because nobody tried to translate the Sanskrit into the Pali for 1,000 years.
Yeah.
And these were all brilliant, genius, great scholarly people.
It's true.
So why would they never do that? Do you follow me? Even short, like Vimalakirti Sutra is only like 50 pages, 60 pages in Sanskrit. It could easily be translated into Pali, but nobody ever did it. I'm going to do, actually, before I die. And I'm going to print it in Bangkok.
Yeah, I agree. That's why I'm coming here, you know. I agree. That's why I think that we need to study the Theravada country.
Need to study
the Mahayana, Mahasanghika too. But they are in practice. You have to understand the Theravada country, they not really study. They got their Tipitaka and they practice.
Okay. No, but they will study.
Are like into this.
They'll study. There's a lot more Abhidhamma.
They practice more than studying, and then they.
Tipitaka is limitless. Nobody can say, oh, now this is only this. No, there's no other thing. More things are discovered, you know. Naga King has more things in their palace, more books than anybody can imagine, you know. So don't worry. Don't worry. Well, there's more things.
Thank you.
For next week, we will look at the Vimalakirti Sutta. And you will get to see Vimalakirti there in Vaishali, no, Vaishali, that town, you know. Have you read a lot of Pali Suttas yourself in English or in Thai or in Pali itself?
No, in Thai.
They translated the whole Pitipaka into Thai?
Long time ago.
Oh, good. Okay.
Many years ago.
Okay. So then the Thai people don't know Pali anymore. Oh, that's terrible. Too bad. That's Pali is supposed to be. They say that Pali is closer to the language Buddha spoke than Sanskrit. But actually, they're so close, you can really, you know, Nibbana, Nirvana, what's the difference?
We're
chanting
in Pali, but we don't understand it. And we need to ask it to try to understand
it. I know.
We're still chanting in Pali.
I know. But for 1,000 years, you know, there were Brahmins in the courts of the kings of Thailand. And there were Vedic rituals were performed there, and there was Buddhism there of all, both Mahayana and even Vajrayana Buddhism. And so even Thai language probably has many Sanskrit words and so forth. I'm sorry, I don't know Thai language, but I'm sure there are. And so it's all going to be rediscovered everywhere, everything. But we really, you know, the Prasangika Madhyamaka really respect the Arhat. And really respect the Pali. I'm saying right here, the non-duality is taught right here in the Pali text. If it's going to be disappearing and extinct and all of that, you know, no more birth. I won't be born again. No more birth. Life is over. I've finished everything. They go on and on like that. But what they really mean by that is no more delusion-driven birth. They're just freaked out about nirmanakaya, you know. Even in that thing to the king, he says, right there, he says he draws out a subtle body out of the coarse body, then goes around and does magical things. If he's saying that's what person does in Samanapala Sutta, you think Buddha can't do that? Buddha's lying under the tree and says they're not breathing anymore. He didn't draw out subtle body and go do something if he wanted to? Of course he did. What's he going to do? Just they can burn the body anytime. You know? How is he, if he had such a power, even ordinary arhat, you think Buddha doesn't have such a power? And he's just going to leave and take a vacation for permanently? It's ridiculous. Why did he bother to teach to start with? If he still doesn't care about people. 45 years he walks around teaching. He wasn't even paid. Didn't have a salary. He got free food, that's all. Only lunch, no breakfast, no supper, just lunch. Any other questions? I think we probably hit the time, but if there's a burning question. Xiaoming, you don't have a question? Come on, Xiaoming. Ni meiyou yi ge wenti. Wei shema? Zai na er ni de wenti.
She has a question.
What the zhong guo fa wo? 不知道. Okay, William. Take care. Don't worry. Stop worrying. Yes.
She has a question.
Oh, you have a question. Oh, good. What's your question?
Yeah.
Last question, though.
I had a question about the equanimity of self and other, and I think by just listening to your conversation
with this.
I had a question about the equanimity of self and other, that idea.
Yes.
And, you know, as we practice, because I feel like nirvana is something that is, it's even a band, name. So just by practice, you know, following the path, and practicing wisdom and compassion, we can have a mind for others, you know, break down that barrier.
Sure.
But
what's the
when
question?
The question was the form realm.
What?
You know, the reality, the material reality, the transformation of material reality.
Yes.
And I mean, just by listening to your conversation with this woman, the Buddha is not only part of the compassionate mind and wisdom, but also part of the material.
Yeah, that's right. Everything,
right?
The Dharmakaya includes everything. Everything. Infinite. Dharmakaya, but that's inconceivable, of course. That's inconceivable. Can't conceive of it, just can't say. We can say, we think we said it all when we said includes everything. But what does that mean? Is everything, actually. It's a vision like that. It's a, you know, saying a word like that is like making a vector like that. But it doesn't encompass the inconceivability of reality, right? That way we live in inconceivable liberation. So nice to see you all here.
Thank you.
Okay? You guys are the hardcore, really. You know? Everybody else is running around watching TV and watching that, and the ridiculous media is threatening us with total psycho to be the president.